Good morning. I'm like Jamie, I can't use my teacher voice. It will come out every now and then. We have been known to be able to be heard over a group. So welcome to Memorial Day service at First United Methodist Church. We're going to start with a song that I hope all of you know, and I want all of you to sing, God Bless America. We're going to sing it twice. Please stand, and hopefully the words are up there. Don't be afraid. Just sing right where you are. God loves your voice, regardless of what it sounds like. That's what I tell songs to God.
Father God, you look for faith and followers and people who remember and are grateful. Memorial Day weekend is about a time of gratitude and about a time of remembering. And so we pray, O God, that you will love and bless us this day as we worship you. In the power of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Now you turn and greet one another.
Thank you.
soldiers, and stand up for Jesus, sitting down, but oh well, it's your call. I thought, as you know, growing up in Sunday school, we sang all the Christian soldiers, and now we don't think a lot about fighting. But we're in a war. We're in a war. Christianity is in a war, so I pulled this out and I thought, this would be fun to do this. Onward Christian soldiers, let's see who remembers it. Maybe a generational thing. And then we'll go straight into stand up for Jesus. But if you need to sit down, don't hesitate.
This week in the life of the church, just a little more. Not too low. This week in the life of the church, we had a memorial service for Chris Newton. Thanks to all of you who were there and who prepared food as we fed the family here. It's just Chris and her life and relationship. I thought it was fascinating that she talked for so many years, and also that on May 22nd she died, that May 22nd was also the day her mother died and an uncle died. Interesting in that family, that those two pieces of information that are there together. We are all in, all of us, and half the world is in transition. There are congregations, you're in transition, I'm in transition, there are congregations in transition all across the conference. It's interesting being in two different places and results of two different sets of meetings and those things that are going on. Can we put the picture of the Atwoods on the screen? So we can leave them up till we can get to prayer time. So I want to continue to pray for the Atwoods. We've had their address in the bulletin, and I don't see it this week, but you can get it out of the office. So you have an opportunity to send information to them, send them a card, send them some kind of word, some sense of encouragement. It all this gets real for all of us pretty soon. And in a couple of weeks, we do what people who are clergy do something that nobody else does, and that's we're gone for 3 days the week before we move. We go to conference, and that's just part of life, and it's one of those interesting things when you're all gone 3 days when you should be packing and getting ready to move. But our last Sunday will be on the 19th. The date is in for on that Thursday night. There'll be a going away dinner, just a casual time to come together. Bobby Hughes is working on hamburgers and some other stuff, food, and so we want to just have a time where we can come and laugh and shed a few tears and express love and joy and say farewell instead of doing that on Sunday. And a couple people said, why aren't we doing it on Sunday? Well, it's Father's Day, so people need to be with their fathers. Also, about 7:30 in the morning on Monday morning, two moving trucks are showing up at our house. So we have a few things that will always be on our list to do. So we just want to get with an opportunity where we can kind of relax that atmosphere on that night. Overflow Contemporary Service begins again tonight at 5:30. If you're free and want to come, or you know folks have been away, want to invite folks, this is a great opportunity. It will grow. It will grow. If we're patient, God is planting some good seeds, and it will grow, and there are a lot of good things that are about that. There are commitment cards in the back, and if we can, if you take some of those and fill those out. If you have not filled one out, our fiscal year ends at the end of the month of June. So it's important for us to make sure we have an opportunity to be a part of that and a chance to participate in what's happening. Renovation is going great. They are moving along nicely, and we're proud of the progress they've made. And we'll try to get some more pictures out and let you begin to see things that are happening and that are taking place. And I'm just proud of that, proud of how much we've been able to watch and see with everything that's a part of that. And blessing on Connie Bristolaire. What's Connie sitting right here? Connie's retiring so she can go teach again. That's what these people do. If you're on Facebook, you look up the Marianna High School valedictorian speech. If you're on YouTube, it's going to be all over YouTube. And there's going to be a test. What does it mean not to be a Jack Wagner? I'm telling you, the guy hit it. It was terrific. It'll be all over the internet. It's going to go places. We should have invited him to preach this morning. He'd be better than me. It was terrific, and so I'm proud of that, Connie and Hunter taking over and all those things that are a part of it. We had the banquet this week for the baseball team, and that was a great success, and it was a great time for the community to gather. And we had all of those baseball players here and their families here, and it was a nice gathering, and it was a special time. Anytime we can open up and bring all those families into this church, the benefit to us is just tremendous. They get to see us and associate. And Bobby Hughes Jr. did a great job with the baseball team, and it was great to be there and celebrate with them and be a part of that occasion. And so that was one of the really nice things happening for all of us. Any other announcements or anything I have missed? We're so grateful to have all these folks up here. I told them we should pass a basket to see who could preach today. They're great folks, and it's great to have them up here behind me and around me. And my honor to be in their presence. And Donna have put all this together and worked very hard on this, and the songsters and all the things that they're doing. And so we are extremely grateful. We turn now into a time of prayer, and certainly we have all those names on our prayer list, and there are a tremendous number of people who are on our private prayer list. We certainly want to remember all those folks. Let's pray silent, and then I'll lead us in a time of prayer.
Thank you.
Gracious God, you brought the children of Israel across the river. And they mounted stones the existence of Joshua, and they became a monument. Monuments are created for memory. Memory so that we will never forget the events that have happened in the past and the people who have been a part of it. We're grateful, O God, that in this nation in which we live, there are monuments and communities. And there are monuments in Washington, and there are monuments in places around the world. There are soldiers of the United States Armed Forces buried in many places where they have given their lives. Not all of them came home. And not all of them were ever identified, and not all of them have been recovered. But, oh God, we pray with great thanksgiving because we never stand alone when we stand in the presence of their memories. We pray, oh God, for the church and the transition that we're going through and for the time in our lives where we are. And we pray, oh God, for this church and for the Atwood family and their preparation to move here. We pray for us, pray for the Elwells in our move to that end for that congregation. And we pray for the Alabama West Florida Conference and all preparation for annual conference on the 12th of June. We pray, oh God, that your Holy Spirit will lead and guide us and that we will be found in the end always to be faithful. We pray for all the folks who are on our prayer list, and we pray your blessing upon them. Give them strength and give them care. For those on extended family, we especially lift up their names. And for those who are deployed and others who we may know who are deployed, and for those who are in the nursing home and homebound, we pray blessings upon them. Grant us, O God, your care and your grace and your peace, as we pray together that prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I'm so proud of the opportunity to turn things over to Miss Janie Nolan.
Come on down. Mr. Truck said get the mic, because I got this old terrible cold and hacking cough. And I've had plenty of,
Is it on? There we go. I had plenty of cough drops, but my tongue's red, look. I want to tell you what I brought with me this morning. In my pocket, let me get down to my pocket. What do I have right there? What is that? Two pennies. I've got two pennies in my hand. You do too? Well, good. Do you know what these two pennies remind me of? They remind me of a story in the Bible that Jesus told. It's found in the 12th book of Mark, I think, about this poor old widow. They were at church one day, and everybody was coming down to give their money, and all these people were putting all this money in their big amounts of money. And this poor old widow, she walked in there, and she put these two pennies in there. And you know what the people of the church did? They started making fun of her and laughing at her. And Jesus told them, you know what? This poor widow gave all she had. She gave more than anybody else in this church. And they said, what'd you say? They said, yes, she gave all she had. And that's what she gave. So in this hand, I've got two pennies. And in this hand, what is this? A flag. And in this hand, I've got a flag. And you know what this reminds me of? This reminds me of somebody else who gave all they had. This reminds me on this Memorial Day weekend, that reminds me of all the men and women that gave their lives, gave all they had, so that you and I could have all the freedom that we have today. So when you see this flag right here, and I'm going to give you one in a minute, I want you to wave it high to salute all those men and women that gave up all they had just so that we could have our freedom. And that reminds me of somebody else who gave up all they had for us. And that was Jesus Christ. Jesus came and gave all he had so that we could have freedom. So this weekend, I want you to think about that poor little old widow who gave all she had, all the men and women who gave all they had, and Jesus Christ who gave all he had so that we could have freedom and everlasting life. Let's bow our heads for a moment of prayer. Dear God, we just thank you for our freedom. We thank you for the men and women that serve in our military, those that gave their lives so that we could have freedom. We just thank you also for Jesus Christ, that he gave what he gave to us so that we could have everlasting life. And all God's children said, Amen.
Please stand for the hymn, America, number 697 in the hymnal. The words should be on the screen.
Oh,
He entered Capernaum. The centurion there had a slave whom he valued highly, who was ill and close to death. When he heard about Jesus, he sent some Jewish elders to him, asking him to come and heal his slave. When they came to Jesus, they appealed to him earnestly, saying, "He is worthy of having you do this for him, for he loves our people, and it is he who built our synagogue for us." And Jesus went with them, but when he was not far from the house, the centurion sent friends to say to him, "Lord, do not trouble yourself, for I am not worthy to have you come under my roof. Therefore I did not presume to come to you, but only speak the word, and let my servant be healed. For I also am a man set under authority with soldiers under me, and I say to one, 'Go,' and he goes, and I say to another, 'Come,' and he comes, and to my slave, 'Do this,' and the slave does it." When Jesus heard this, he was amazed at him, and turning to the crowd that followed him, he said, "I tell you, not even in Israel have I found such faith." When those who had been sent returned to the house, they found the slave in good health. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Let us pray. And now, God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight. The Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. It was a cool, chilly morning on a Saturday. It was 3:45 in the morning. And I gathered with a group of gentlemen in Prattville, Alabama, standing on a certain particular place in the city street. And there were a series of school buses that were parked down the street from us. This was the morning that I was one of the guardians on an honor flight. Flight left from the river region. What was significant to me and to all of us as we were there, and we were supposed to be there at 4:00, and as we all began to gather, we had a moment of prayer before all of our veterans showed up, our people that we were in charge of. Each person that goes, mostly each person has one guardian. Sometimes that one guardian will have two veterans that will go. So we, all of this work had gone into this, and money had been raised, and all the things that would go into that. I had on more than one occasion driven to the airport and had prayer with this group before they flew. So I had been, was a little bit aware of some of the things that had gone on. Prior to that, most of us, as we sat around, began to tell stories about our particular veterans that we were to be guardians for. Most of us told the same story, and that was that we had to go visit them in their house, and we had to talk to them into going on this experience. Some of it, obviously, was because of health, and that is one of the reasons that there are not many honor flights going now, because age and health has become part of the issue. But the main reason that we had to go sit and convince these folks that they needed to go and accept this opportunity is because most of them said, well, I didn't do anything. I just went there. I just served. I did what I was told to do. I went where they told me to go. I wore the uniform that they gave me to wear. And when the war was over, I came home. I didn't do anything special. And so you had to convince these people that they were, that this was an opportunity for them not only to come together, but an opportunity for them to make their way to Washington, D.C., and see the World War II Memorial and the Korean Memorial and be a part of that whole experience and make their way back. They were also, just to give you a sense of trying to understand what was going on, they were loading 100 wheelchairs on another vehicle that was going to go with us on the plane. And there were all kinds of other medical personnel, so there were all kinds of things. And we had all this precious cargo that we had. So we got there and we were telling the stories, and I offered a prayer, and we sort of circled up in prayer, all of us who were going to be guardians, and we made a day of it, and the veterans were showing up in their families, and there were pictures being taken, there were flashes going off in the dark. By the time I got on the bus, I could not see anything for the spots in front of my eyes. But this was Christmas Day. This was like Christmas Day. We got on the buses and we made our way to the airport and we got on the plane. And let me tell you, watching all those veterans go through TSA with all their hips and knees and everything else and all that they had and plates and places and all those kind of metal plates and places and all that was an interesting experience. And let me tell you, they had the most fun with those TSA folks, and they had the most fun with them. It was great. It was just fun watching all of that. We got on our airplane, and I offered prayer, and we left, and we went to Washington, D.C., and we had this experience, and we landed. And when we landed, there were all these military personnel who were there to shake hands with all of these folks that were there. They didn't know who any of these people were. But when you come through Washington, D.C. with a police escort, and you come down from that airport, people began to know who you were. It was a marvelous experience, and they began to tell stories, and the stories that they told were stories about people that were their friends, and people that were lost, and people that were no longer a part of life, and as they began to tell those stories, it was like a Memorial Day weekend moment. Every time one of them would tell a particular story, there were two or three that had lost a brother. One lost a sister who had been a nurse. We made our way to Washington, D.C., and we made our way to the World War II Memorial. And as soon as they got there, the first thing they wanted to see was Kilroy. Kilroy was here as part of the monument. And as soon as they saw that, it began to throw their minds back to the occasion and the things that happened. And they were there, and as they were standing there, they still said, this moment, we're not worthy to be standing here. And one of the most touching moments, they said, we're not worthy because this is about those who died. And we went home. And then one of them said, thank you to the Lord, the people that were lost are not forgotten. It was a great moment. It was a great moment being a part of that and hearing that conversation and being a part of that. And then, and I'm sure I got to go to my notes on this one because it's a breaking news. And if you've been, anybody been to the World War II Memorial? Anybody seen World War II? How great the World War II Memorial is. Joanna Campbell Blake, who worked for Caskey Studios, designed a tremendous number of those statues that are there. She did a lot of that sculpting that is there, and she was known for that, and did another bit of sculpting. She is an Auburn graduate, and she grew up in Mobile, Alabama, and she died last week in a motorcycle accident. I found out that they had laid a wreath for her next to one of those great sculptures that are there. That created such a tremendous experience. And what she said, when given the opportunity to put that together, she said the standard line, and so many of us say, I'm not worthy to do this for the veterans. I'm not worthy at all. I think it's from unworthiness sometimes we have that sense of humility that things begin to turn, and that we discover what's most important, and then it's certainly not all about us. The story that we have in the gospel is a story about Jesus and a centurion. A centurion is a Roman army official, and centurions were not greatly loved because they had charge of 100 men. And somebody said there's nothing more dangerous in the Roman army. A legion may be dangerous, but a centurion, a bad centurion, who's in charge of 100 soldiers, Roman soldiers, is a really dangerous thing to have on the face of the earth. So he sends word to Jesus. And he'd heard about Jesus. He sends word to Jesus, and he says to him, I have a servant. Except he kept saying servant, but the translation kept coming out, and many of the translations come out and says slave. Notice that the assistants to him came and said, those who worked with him, and said, our master has a slave, and he says, and the master says, I have a servant. There's an interesting dynamic that's going there. And so he sends word, sends people to come to Jesus. And so Jesus is there, and he is, and so they come to him after Jesus has finished speaking in Capernaum, and they say to Jesus, Lord, we have a centurion. He built our synagogue for us. While centurions are hated, we love this man. And this man whom we love has a servant, has a servant who is dying, and he is so concerned about the servant, he sent us to you because he believes that if we came to you, that something could happen. Now, I'm sure that those who are standing around Jesus thought, well, my goodness, he sends his servants, his second in command, his lower people, the messengers. He sends those people to come to Jesus because he's in such a high position, he can't be bothered. That would be the normal kind of view or situation or words that we might want to say. He sent somebody because he can't be bothered by that. Suddenly Jesus says, well, I'm going to go see him. You think so much of him, I want to go see him. So Jesus makes his own trek and he goes to see him. And he goes to the house of there. And when he gets closer, the centurion sends word. He says to Jesus, I didn't come because I'm not worthy. Here's a man in a great position of authority who's not asking for something for himself. He's not asking for something he could maybe could buy. He's not asking to use his influence or throw anything around. He didn't send his whole army to go bring Jesus back and kidnap him because I want to have an audience with him. What he essentially said, sent a servant to him to do something about my servant. And when Jesus showed up, he said, I'm not worthy. I'm not worthy. I'm not worthy is where things began to be important and where important things began to take place. It's the same word we heard from all of those folks. And as we walked through monument after monument and place after place, and they talked about the Pacific and they talked about the Atlantic and they talked about their experiences and they talked about what they did. And the small guy who I had, who kept telling me that in the war, they wanted people of all kinds of sizes to do different kinds of jobs. I said, what did you do? He said, well, my job wasn't all that important. And I said, what did you do? He said, I ran an anti-tank gun. I said, what does that mean? He says, well, it's a small gun. You see that in a lot of town squares, these small gun. He said, you have about 3 shells. You find a panzer tank. You aim it. You fire. And then you run. That's my job. And you better hide. Because he's got a bigger gun than you have. I said, where did you do your job? He said, oh, places, you know, I was at Normandy and I was at NZO, and I started naming all these places where he had done his job. We spent the day, and everywhere we went, we had lunch sitting on the bus, and these guys were, they were getting tired. And so we really had to pay attention to them. As part of the training we had to go through, you had to pay a great sense of attention to them when they were, as they were tired. But the more time we spent with them, we discovered that it didn't matter if you were a sergeant, and it didn't matter if you were a captain, and it didn't matter if you were a colonel, and it didn't matter if you were a private, it didn't matter who you were a veteran, and you were there, and you wore the t-shirt, you wore the hat, you were a part of the whole experience. They even did a great thing when they got on the plane going back after they had their experience. They handed them mail from a third grade class that had sent, written letters to them. And so somebody stood up and said, "Mail call!" And you should have seen them all stand up, sit up straight. The rest of us were about half asleep. But I'll never forget the moment when we got to Arlington. When I was young, we went to Arlington. Man, I was so small, but I remember everything about that. I remember that experience. It left a great impression on me. I've been to Arlington two or three times since then, and it just was a great experience. And we got to Arlington, and we got to the bus, and what we discovered was that the ones that were leaned over were standing up taller. And the ones who couldn't hardly walk were walking faster. And the ones that couldn't hardly get around found a way to get around. We saw people stand up out of wheelchairs in moments. Like when you would be at a place and they would stop and play the national anthem, or something would happen, or something would go by. We got to Arlington Cemetery and we pulled the buses in, and the rest of us who were the guardians drug off the bus. We were absolutely tired. We turned around and all the veterans had made it up the hill. And they made their way to Arlington. You know, and that's a great experience to think that for 78 years, every second, there has been somebody marching 21 steps down that patterned walk that they have. And all of that experience, no matter if it's in the middle of the night, and they come in and change the guard, and they go through the same ceremony, they could do it if their eyes are closed, there's nobody there, it's pouring down rain. It's bitterly cold, it never shuts down, it never does anything, and they all wanted to go to Arlington because Arlington reminds us that nobody ever forgets. Because remembering is important. We watched that great experience. And we turned around and we looked, as all those guys were there, and they were like the kid, we were all kind of exhausted, and we were there, and there was a general. And the general came up to a couple of us and said, "Where are you from?" And we told him. "We're from Montgomery area, Prattville, Central Alabama. We're part of the River Region Honor Flag." He said, "One of these days I want to go on one of those with some folks." He turned around and said, "Could I have my picture made with this group?" That was an amazing thing. "Could I have my picture made with this group?" And somebody said, "Well, General, I'm one of his aides said, General, I'm sure you're busy, you've got things." He said, No, I want my picture made with this group." And so we got them all together. It's like herding cats. We got them all together. And we got them in front of everybody. And the general was just about to walk up to them. And he stopped, and he went to attention, and he saluted them. Now, let me tell you something. That's another rich moment. It's another quote that I found this week in my reading. It's very important. It said, "For most of history, humans were taught to treat those above them as kings and to treat those below them as slaves. Jesus taught that everyone, whether below or above, should be treated with respect, but that those below needed to be treated with especially well, not as if you were their tyrant, but as if they were you, and as if they were him." Now forget that general saluting all those veterans. They all became younger. The stories became richer. And not a single one of them slept on the way back. And it all started with a feeling, I'm not worthy. One of those startling statements Jesus made in the entire Bible came at the end of this particular story when he's had the encounter with the centurion, and he looked and the centurion said, I'm not worthy to come in your presence. That's why I sent somebody else. It's not because I was too busy and I had to go to the beach, or my child had to go somewhere, my grandchild's in travel ball, or something had to go on, or I've got some other thing I had to do. I sent someone because he said, I'm not worthy. Not worthy. And Jesus said, never in all of Israel, and he could have said this to all his disciples who were standing around him, who had traveled with him and who had given up their jobs and had given up their families and had given up a lot of things. And there were former tax collectors who had given up being wealthy, and there were zealots who had given up fighting Romans. And there were all kinds of people who were gathered in that band, the folks that were traveling with Jesus, and many of them are folks that had been healed. And Jesus said, never have I in Israel found any faith as great as this. Because when you look for what's most important, it usually begins with somebody thinking, I'm not worthy. We landed in Montgomery, and they had all of these cadets that were going through officer candidacy with the Air University, and they were all lined in the tarmac where we were. And we walked in, and the news media was there, and there was a band that was playing, and there was crowds, and there were families, and they came home to Heroes Welcome, and there was a 3-star general from Air University, and a 2-star general, and a 1-star general, and all the officers, and we shook hands with all those folks, and they had their pictures taken, and they were all interviewed, and we got on the bus, and we took some of them to meet their families, but most of the families got them and took them back, and all the guardians were on the bus, and you've never heard snoring like that in your entire life. But when we got off the bus, as tired as we were, I love what Jim Byard, who had been the mayor of Prattville, said. Every time I go on this, and every time I spend time with these folks, you know what feeling I have? I'm not worthy. I hope you're not worthy moment. And where you encounter Jesus, and where you find what's the most important thing in your entire life. Jesus didn't come to find people who knew the whole Sunday school lesson, or people who could memorize all the names of the 66 books of the Bible, or the 613 laws, or who abided by every one of those, or used faith as a missile to use to attack other people, or people who spent their life making judgment on other folks. But Jesus wants to find the people of faith who will follow him. It doesn't matter if your politics is right, left, or however your politics is. It doesn't matter how you matter, you think on some issues about life. All those things will be taken care of. What matters most is it begins with the feeling that I'm not worthy enough, but I'm going to accept the invitation of Jesus. And I'm going to be a follower. It says that those people who had come to Jesus went home and they found the servant. To be in tremendous health. As a matter of fact, if you read the translation, it says they found the servant to be healthier than he'd ever been for many years of his life. We live in this Memorial Day. And when we look around, we're not worthy. But that's where we discover what's most important in this life that has been given to us. Let's pray. with the Lord our lives. Help us find those moments when we feel like we're not worthy. But in those moments, they will be found with the most important thing. And the most important thing is our faith in Jesus Christ. You even eat with sinners, O Lord. You take everybody and invite them in. And that's where life's transformation begins every single day. And we're grateful, O God, because we know that we're not worthy.